Thank you for listening to The History of the Papacy. I am your host, Steve. You can find show notes, how to contact me, sign up for our mailing list, and learn how to support The History of the Papacy by going to our website, a2zhistorypage.com. Speaking of supporting the show, Patreon is a great way to do that. We are at patreon.com/historyofthepapacy. There are four tiers: Antioch, Alexandria, Constantinople, and Rome. Inclusion on the History of the Papacy diptychs, bonus audio, video content, monthly book drawings, and early ad-free content are all yours to be had if you support the show on Patreon. Your support on Patreon also goes a long, long way to really helping this show remain sustainable for a long time in the future. I am also introducing a new benefit, which is Popecoin. With the rise of cryptocurrencies and all that stuff, Popecoin is your little piece of the history of the papacy. It's a commemorative coin that I will ship to you as a new supporter of the history of the papacy at any level. So I hope there's only a very limited number of these coins. All current patrons are going to get this coin as well. So if you want to get a Pope coin and have your little piece of the history of the papacy podcast, you need to sign up now. And also another reason to sign up now is to get on the History of the Papacy diptychs. The earlier you sign up for the History of the Papacy podcast, the higher you will be on the list. I would like to send out a special thanks to our latest patrons, and there's a lot of them today. At the Alexandria level, we have William H., reaching that ultimate power and prestige, that of the See of Rome. We have Leonard, now termed Leonard the Great. At the Antioch level, we have Benjamin, and increasing his prestige from Antioch all the way up to that ultimate power and prestige, that of the See of Rome, we have Alex, now Alex the Great. Thank you so much, William, Leonard the Great, Benjamin, and Alex the Great. I really appreciate the support of everyone on Patreon. It is a great way to help keep the history of the papacy going and sustainable. Now, let us commemorate the Patreon patrons on the History of the Papacy diptychs. We have Roberto, Joran, William, Brian, Jeffrey, Christina, John, Sarah, and William H. at the Alexandria level, Dapo, Paul, Justin, Lana, and John, all of whom are magnificent at Constantinople, and reaching that ultimate power and prestige, that of the See of Rome, we have Peter the Great, Leonard the Great, and Alex the Great. As you know, we are a member of the Parthenon Podcast Network, now featuring Josh Cohen's Eyewitness History, among many other great shows. Go over to ParthenonPodcast.com to learn more. Now, today, we are joined by our good friend Gil Kedron from a podcast of biblical proportions to discuss a theory that just might literally rewrite how we view the Old Testament. In this episode, Gil will dramatically set up an interesting theory he has developed to explain some very interesting connections between the writing styles in specific books of the Bible. In the next episode, Gil will flesh out his ideas even more to create a compelling literary analysis. You won't want to miss either part. With that, here is the next piece of the mosaic of the history of the popes of Rome and Christian Church. I'd like to welcome back Gil of the podcast of Biblical Proportions, yet again, live from Israel. Well, not technically live for me, maybe not live for the people out there. And we are going to talk about a fascinating topic in biblical history. Thank you so much for coming on again, Gil.
Hey, Stephen, I'm very happy to talk to you again.
Thank you. Today we're going to talk about a topic of Genesis and Exodus. Your podcast, maybe just to prep people a little bit and tell us a little bit about your podcast and where you're coming from with your podcast, the podcast of Biblical Proportions.
The way we approach the text is basically try to glean from the stories some clues and information about the writers in the same way that we intuitively do with the movies. If you watch a movie that you've never seen before and you're not told that it's by Quentin Tarantino, you'll watch the movie, you'll recognize it as such, you know, Steven Spielberg and such. We can intuitively understand how we can get a feel for the people behind the story when it's a movie. Or any story, any literature. If we view the Bible as literature, which some of it clearly is, some of it is history and, you know, songs and other stuff. But let's say Genesis and Exodus, those are ancient tales that, you know, a lot of words, a lot of characters, a lot of plots. If you, I'm a Hebrew speaker, so if you look at it as such, you'll get a sense of the values of what kind of people wrote this story and that story. How did they view the deity? What were they afraid of? What were they excited towards? So this is the frame of mind that I like to have when I read the Bible. And just got through Genesis now, the first season.
That's what I really enjoy about your podcast, is that it's a huge book. If you take from... If you go from Genesis through the Hebrew Bible, and then you go through the New Testament part of it, there's multiple different genres, and you can't read every genre the same way. You have to approach them in each different way. And I think that's where a lot of people get tied up, is you want to read Exodus the exact same way that you're going to read Daniel or something like that, or Revelation versus whatever. And you have to approach those texts very differently in order to get something out of them. And the other thing that I really like about the podcast, that I had like four things I was going to say here of things I really like. But I think the other thing that I really like is that you're looking at it of how the people who wrote it imagined it, because every single person from the BCE, a little bit later, they imagine the text a little bit differently, and we imagine the text a little bit differently. And then the other thing that I really like about the podcast is that as a Hebrew speaker, you have a very different and individual way that you can approach the text. You can see this, like you were saying, that some of these texts are poetry, some of them are songs. And if you're reading your Bible today in, for example, English, you're looking at it through a translation. I've said this a million times on the podcast, but it went from some sort of old Hebrew to Aramaic to Greek to Latin to some sort of weird French to old English to a modern English, depending on what you're reading. So you're not getting that poetic meter, the song meter that the authors were trying to get through.
That is very interesting, because the purpose of the translations were never, as you said, to get across the poetry, the soul. That's not the purpose of the translation, because that was not the purpose of the book for the people who were doing the translating, either for theological reasons or just, you know, to make it simple so we can understand it. But unless you know that you're supposed and you have the, you know, the skills to bring the poeticness into other languages, then it will just fade away. And, you know, even learning about the Bible here in Israel, we also don't have any emphasis on the poetry. Before I started this podcast more than a year ago, I was fascinated by the Bible, but from afar. I didn't get the sense that it was, you know, high literature. And now combing through Genesis, I'm just like blown away. I'm not a scholar. I'm a writer and a podcaster. And I'm blown away by the techniques, by the art, how they produce drama in different ways and the conflicts and resolutions. And I think that if we bring that perspective, I think there are a lot of new things that we can find in the book, specifically in Genesis and peeking a little bit to Exodus. That's where, I put my energies right now. And you find a different story, a new story that is so much better than the regular theological story or just like run of the mill. Abraham, Jacob, Joseph did this and God and that. That is frankly not interesting. And now I think that Genesis is the best book that was ever written.
I think I really enjoy, and I think if people listen to your podcast, when you'll read little bits of it in Hebrew, I don't speak
like
in Hebrew, so yeah, I don't speak a word of Hebrew, but you can tell when you're reading it, like the bump, 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 the tone that comes through, or the song. You can even tell if you don't speak a word of Hebrew that there's a meter to it. It's just like reading Shakespeare, the way he organizes the words.
Yeah.
Puts through so much more as much meaning as the words themselves, and you miss that through translation.
And if I'll ever read Shakespeare in Hebrew, I'm sure it will suck. I tried to read Game of Thrones and The Hobbit in Hebrew. Horrible. Doesn't work at all.
Yeah, and so many things with bad translations too. The older translations, they didn't try to put through. Mechanical translations, like you'll see on Google Translate, they're just awful because they're missing the whole, soul, I guess you might say, of what's the person's trying to say.
Yeah, the artist that, if it's literature, then from what we know about how people write, they pour themselves into the story. Whether they're talking about a sci-fi movie taking place in the year 2500, or if it's in a fantastical Middle Earth, or whatever it is, the writer always puts himself, his characters, his feelings into the text. And just thinking about it, that so many of those very, very, very famous biblical tales that we all know and grew up on to some degree or other. I don't know if you live in the Western world, whatever, in Asia, it's different. Don't care as much as us about it. Then it's just fascinating to if you look for it, you find the personal lives of the people who wrote it in the stories of Genesis. I'm just like, I can't, keep my mind from getting blown whenever I think about it. It's just insane.
Now, the writers and the real story, that really leads into what we're talking about today. And we're talking about today of who wrote this book, Genesis. And before, you have some new ideas and some new scholarship that's coming out on who wrote Genesis. But what's maybe the standard story? What does somebody learn if they're in Bible 101? What do they learn? Who wrote Genesis?
So I'm not a scholar, and I can't say that I'm an expert in biblical scholarship. I'm gonna talk to our mutual friend Gary Stevens soon. And he will put my theories into rigorous testing. But I researched this for myself, guerrilla, going online, reading all kinds of different stuff about all the things that scholarship has told us that are either true or probably true. And in between those boundaries, if you add the literary and the human element, then you see that there is a story that fits all known scholarship as far as I could find it. So in the last century or so, the popular way to look at the Bible was that there are four sources, the E, Elohist, when God is referred to as Elohim, the deity. There's the J, Yahwist, when the deity is called Yahweh, Jehovah, whatever it is, the Deuteronomist who wrote Deuteronomy, and P, that's the priestly. And that was just like the first time that scholars accepted the fact that there are different writers. In the past decades, this theory has proven that it's no longer helpful as such, and it has been modified with, you know, new knowledge. And now there's like a supplementary hypothesis that says like most of the Bible was written either before the sack of Jerusalem in 586 BCE or after that in exile. When they say in exile, they mean in the Babylonian exile after the city was sacked. And some have clear Hellenistic and Greek influences, so they must be later. Also mentions of Cyrus, Koresh, so that also times it. And this timeline, I think there's a, like how, okay, you come in.
And now a word from our sponsors. The Elohim, sometimes God's referred to as Elohim, sometimes he's referred to Yahweh or Jehovah. What does that mean exactly? They call it like the name or something? Is that?
I think it's, in some ways, it's kind of overemphasized those differences because there were so many changes to the deities. When most of the stories were put to text, there was no Judaism. There was no monotheism. So there were many deities, and there are many deities in the Bible. And sometimes they were called this way, sometimes they were called another way. Through the generations of the editing, they canonized it as two ways to refer to the deity. Sometimes you have more, but Elohim, it literally means deities, even though in Hebrew now, this is also our word for God, but it's in plural. And the singular El, that was a Canaanite god from the northern state of Israel, of the kingdom of Israel, not the state of Israel. but I think that this is not the right way to split up the text because it's all mangled up. It's Yahweh one sentence, Elohim another sentence, and you have people who are politically opposed to each other. For example, Jeremiah, he's politically opposed to the king of Jerusalem, king of Judah, just before the sacking. Both of them believe in Yahweh. So that wouldn't be a very helpful way to understand what was going on, because even this book became theological later. It was a political story that people told in order to justify themselves, their actions, explain the destruction that just happened to them in Jerusalem and their exile. And we had two factions. You can read it's in the book of Jeremiah, which is also kind of weird how you have two rival enemy factions inside the biblical narrative fighting with each other. Do you think it's a good time to get into the details a little bit of the siege, or what do you think?
Before that, I'm just wondering, why did scholars think that this text had four different writers or editors?
It's interesting. I think that if you are not a native Hebrew speaker, it's really hard to see all the edits. But once you read it, you know, a few times that you get a sense of the text. For example, the story of Joseph, it's very glaring because it's a beautifully written story. It's a positive story. It's an emotional human story. And it just like flows with emotion like water. And then in an instant, you would have like a rant against one of the tribes, you know, the eponymous character of the tribes that is doing this and doing that. And it would be just like so clunky and like, okay, this is not the same writer, the same story, because that little mini episode rant would end and then would go back to Joseph and it would again be just like beautiful and organic. So if you read the story in the language in which it was written and you read it, you know, enough and you get a sense of the flow of the text, you were saying yourself, right? You hear the flow in the words. And then if there's something that, you know, just like pasted in between, that you can also understand the reasoning why it would be, because they want to emphasize that this guy wasn't really a good guy because they had a problem, they had a beef with the tribe, or maybe you emphasize too much Elohim. I need to put a little bit of Yahweh here because it's not Joseph that did all this by himself. No, let me add a line that says Yahweh blessed it. So just like it also, there's a lot of common sense into it. And it's internally consistent. Once you start noticing this, you see it all over the place. So that also reinforces, you know, it for me.
Now we're getting into that, your idea, and there's the scholarship of thinking that this was one person who wrote that. So who is this one person then?
I don't know if he wrote the whole thing, but I would give him and Jeremiah the title of the biblical authors of Genesis because they were in charge of the project. Jeremiah was told by Yahweh to write a book, so he had to get a scribe. And that scribe's name was Baruch ben Neriah. And he is widely accepted to be the person who wrote the majority of the book of Jeremiah, because it's also explained pretty clearly in the book, and there's no reason to suspect that it's not him. It just like fits. You know, he's not pushing himself too much or promoting himself, so it just like it makes sense. And from what we know of how things were done back then. And if you go over their lives as it's told in the book of Jeremiah and the events that they went through during the siege, the Babylonian siege of Jerusalem, and they were in the anti-war faction. They wanted to submit to the Babylonians. The king and court said, no, Yahweh will protect us. We will be independent. And in Hebrew, first of all, there are tons of expressions that are very unique. I don't want to overstate it tons. There are expressions that are very unique in the book of Jeremiah that appear in the book of Genesis and nowhere else, or only in one other place. And for example, like I don't know your audience, if I should get how much into the weeds.
Let's get into the weeds.
Let's We're get here. Okay, so like the way it started, the whole thing. Let me tell you, Stephen, because do you know this meme? My brain is in recovery mode from high level ideas by Dave Rubin. You know, just like a silly person, whatever. But so people made fun of him for saying that. But I felt like I sprained my mind just like by overextending it. It before, you know, beyond its capability. So I was reading a book, a biblical scholarship book by Professor Igal Ben-Nun. He's kind of like a rogue scholar, not accepted by the establishment. And he wrote a book a couple of years ago about Yahweh and about who he thinks is the biblical author of the book of Deuteronomy. And he makes a very simple and convincing case. The person who wrote Deuteronomy was the head scribe of the king that he had personally to gain from the laws in the book. While the king and the priest, it was the new laws in the book of Deuteronomy hurt their standing. So it stands to reason that, you know, the person who's writing stuff for himself would be the person to write it. So as I'm reading it, there was this paragraph from Jeremiah, I think it's Jeremiah 36, where Baruch ben Neriah puts on text some of Jeremiah's most explosive prophecies about how the Babylonians are going to destroy Jerusalem. And the moment it's put on text, it just becomes like politically explosive, which is just like so cool to think about and to read how they summon a cabinet meeting. And they hear the text themselves from Baruch ben Neriah. And the moment they hear it, it's, oh my goodness, we have to tell the king about this. Just like imagine the importance of the words on the scroll, words that Jeremiah has been saying for months and years. We don't know how long, and nobody cared. But now it's on text. So this also just gives us like a window to understand how they view text and the important role of the scribe. So the king gets that scroll and he burns the words of Yahweh. And like it's emphasized that how horrible it is, how disrespectful it is. And Jeremiah is, livid, and he gives a prophecy there that the king, his body would be exposed to the heat by day and to the frost by night. And I'm reading it here in my balcony, and I almost have a stroke because I was like, I just read that exact same line a week ago in the story of Jacob. Such a weird and unique line. I'm like, okay, let me read it again. Let me look at it. Let me see if it's anywhere else in the Bible. No, nowhere else in the Bible. So I'm like, okay, maybe this guy wrote it. Like, it's not inconceivable. Like, someone wrote it, right? So I started to compare the book of Jeremiah and the book of Genesis in terms of where it takes place. You have in the Bible, you have a clear division between herders and farmers. So that had to fit geographically, also politically, it had to fit. It just had to fit the timeline, and also literarily, and the characters and the expressions. It just like had to be. I kept trying to, you know, find evidence. So just like it, you know, blew my mind. And then I went to a friend of mine and just like, I couldn't stop talking about it. Honestly, for 4.5 months, just couldn't stop talking about it. And I was telling him about it, and I was recounting the story of Jeremiah. And I was like, Jeremiah, everybody hated him and they beat him up and they threw him in the pit. And I'm like, wait, that's the story of Joseph. He had prophecies that people hated listening to, and they beat him up and they threw him in a pit. I'll never forget that moment. Literally, I couldn't think for like a week later, just like about anything. Just like it's, I don't know, my neurons. I don't have enough neurons to just like, to feel that you can get a sense from these iconic stories of like the real people and just like the real personal drama that they had, because they were friends of sorts. It was a complicated relationship, but just like to reach out beyond, you know, space and time, you know, beyond Shakespeare, just right next to Homerus. I think it's a privilege. That's how I feel about it. And as far as I could tell, it's so sound. I have like a ton of evidence that I like list at the end of one of the episodes. What did you think about it? How do you see it?
And now a word from our sponsors. I thought it was really interesting because it's something that I'd never heard before. I'll freely admit I've never read Jeremiah, so I don't really know, and I don't know much about him either, but I thought it was really fascinating and kind of mind-bending the way Jeremiah has a book and it's set in his time, but then Jeremiah and a scribe write a book that is a lot about their times that's set in the way distant past. And just the way you showed that all those different things that he's talking about, the things that really show up in the Genesis account, it's very hard to wrap your mind around.
Right? It is. And you know what? Just like my favorite tidbit that is blowing my mind is that, and you know, a lot of these things, I should say, it will be very hard to refute because it's a literary analysis, right? So it's like, it would be hard to say that this literary analysis is wrong. Maybe it is wrong, but I don't know, just come up with a better literary analysis and maybe you have a better one. I don't mind. I don't know if like my takes are, you know, 100% correct, but that's also something interesting. So this very Jacob tale that had this prophecy against the king written into it was Jacob in a feud with his uncle from the east, Laban. And just like reading through it, and as you said, reading with comparing it with what Jeremiah says about his time, you can directly connect it to this uncle being their take of what Nebuchadnezzar II, the king of Babylon at that time, what they think that he was like as a person, as a person. I'm like reading this story, and it's a great story, Jacob and Laban story. I don't know how it is in English, but in Hebrew, it's a really, really good. And also a lot of Shakespearean monologues. And I'm reading it, and like, it feels like a treasure. I can, you know, I don't know if they ever met Nebuchadnezzar, but I'm pretty sure they know more about him and they have a better sense of him than any of us living now to his character.
Jeremiah, he lived in the 500-ishes BCE. Did they have an idea in their mind in the 500-ish BCE when Genesis was taking place? Was it just like the distant past kind of thing?
Yeah. How would they know? Why would they know? Why would they care? Like they're not trying to prove anything, and they're not trying to hide what you said, that they're talking about the present in the form of an ancient tale. It's not a trick. This is plain to see for the audience. It's like special effects in a movie. We know that he's not shooting, you know, lightnings from his hands, but this is the format and we enjoy ourselves.
Were these stories of Joseph and all the Genesis stories, were they floating around already? And is it that Jeremiah was the one who codified them or put them into text format with his spin on them?
Jacob definitely existed before Jeremiah as a folk hero, because it's mentioned in other earlier books. So I guess it's because Ben Neria was a very good scribe, a very good writer. So his stories are the ones that made it, you know, into the final edition. And also, I think that he was the one who was picking which stories made it. So, for example, Sodom and Gomorrah, the famous story that we know is, for me, and again, I'm not a scholar, but, you know, I'm daring to be wrong, but it seems pretty clear that it's about Jerusalem, and that Jerusalem is the horrible city that's referred to in Sodom. I don't think that they invented the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. It's just the only version that we have is the one that is Jerusalem. Joseph, though, I would put all my money on that being a new story, new character. Also, the name Joseph Yasaf, an addendum, an extension. So that's also an extension to the patriarch. So that also fits thematically. And also, the story of Joseph is just like 100% Jeremiah's life and Baruch Ben Neriah's life, written as an ancient tale with like their deepest emotions and like their rivalry and love and everything, all of that in the story itself. This, I know, again, I'm not a scholar, but I don't know how someone could refute something that is so clearly there that anyone can understand. Everything happens that happens to Joseph is a symbolic retelling of what happened to Jeremiah and Baruch ben Neriah. I go into all the details in the episode. I spoiled a little bit the ending there. But a friend of mine who has heard a lot about it said that when he listened to the episode, it still works, even if you know. So, I don't know.
What about those really early parts of it, like the days of creation and Adam and Eve and all that stuff?
This is a good question. Like if I had like a, you know, scholarship from university, I would do nothing else but read over and over and over Genesis. I just read it so many times that I would just like have to read it again to just like, you know, be sure of what my opinion is. From all the reading that I've done up to now, I would say that I'm leaning towards Baruch ben Neriah writing the first creation story, the famous creation story. I got some sense of the style that could be him, but I would put it like at 60%. Then there are a lot of stories that are very heavily edited and just like, frankly, are not as good. So it might be him before he went to Egypt and had time to properly write everything and put it text. Or these were, you know, other scribes, because there were other scribes in his community. Maybe I should mention that after the sack of Jerusalem, the king, and not the king, was killed, but the court and the mutineers, they're off to Babylon, to exile. And the remaining elite, they head down to Egypt. And there, Baruch ben Neriah writes the story of Joseph symbolically as Israel. This is Jacob, Israel in Genesis, going down to Egypt, all the tribes symbolically. And there, there's a, you know, there they have the time to turn it into a book, a proper book.
Who was running the show in Egypt when Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians conquer Israel and Jerusalem?
So this is interesting. I wish I had thought of looking into it before I recorded the main episode about Baruch ben Neriah. So I looked into what was the status of the scribes in Egypt. And I was just like blown away again, because it fit everything that we know about the status of Baruch ben Neriah, who we should mention was a supremely famous person. in his lifetime and for thousands of years after he died. So it's not some weirdo that just like I'm pointing and saying this person, this nobody. No, this is an accomplished, very accomplished person. And the story of Joseph. Joseph's role in the story is to collect taxes and be in communication with the Pharaoh and his officials and be like the head of the community. And that was the role of the scribes in ancient Egypt. So this is another instance that shows how the author, the writer, Baruch ben Neriah, put himself into this story. And if we look at his life and we compare it to Joseph, just like it fits. It's just like everything fits.